Microelectronic is the art of miniaturizing. Starting at the first step, looking to the cochlear implant for hearing. Actually, you have the chip. It's on some PCB. From PCB, you have some outlet. Those outlet, you connect electrode with wiring, and those electrode can interface the nerve. And from the other side, you have a radio frequency system to remotely receive energy to power up and exchange data. It means you can measure what's happening and you can receive data to turn on, turn off, update the parameter because our body is changing. You have the nerve, you have two contact. These two contact means to inject current and stimulate, or these two contact is to listening what's happening. We are developing a chip system to implant inside the brain, and this chip role is to detect onset maybe 15, 20 seconds before the seizure starts.
Wow.
And inject some drug or stimulate the region to stop it.
To stop it.
Yeah. In general, my career is doing chip for all those bio applications. Okay, so system on chip. I was doing this for 28 years now.
Even though someone's opinion may contradict yours.
Where's my friend Alan?
It's all about your perspective. Who are we and what is the nature of this reality?
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. What's up, everyone? Welcome to Simulation. I'm your host, Alan Sakyan. We are on site at the beautiful Westlake University in Hangzhou, China. We are now going to be talking about brain-machine interfaces. We have Dr. Mohamed Sawan joining us on the show. Hi, Mohamed.
Hi.
Thank you so much for coming on the show.
Thank you.
I'm so excited for this conversation. For those who don't know Mohamed's background, he is chair professor of microelectronics and bioengineering at Westlake University, where his lab is focused on neurotechnology to tackle neurodegenerative disease. And you can find all of the links in the bio below. All right, Mohamed, let's start things off with one of our favorite questions. We like asking our guests, what are your thoughts on the direction of our world?
Wow, okay. Well, thank you so much again. The world is, of course, interesting. Life is interesting. Progress everywhere. I'm traveling everywhere. I am very excited to see evolution everywhere. Everything is moving on the right direction, I hope. Life is interesting, and everyone has to do his homework to contribute to this move, you know.
Yes,
so
yes.
Life is fantastic.
Yes, everyone plays their unique role in making life better and
absolutely,
better for everyone.
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely.
What would you say is a key skill or essential thing for us to possess and develop as humans that help us ensure a beautiful future?
Wow, okay, it means in fundamental issue is really to believe on own capacity and do what exactly we like to do in life and push. I think push as maximum as we can I think human capacity is major, is big, and never underestimate what we can do to contribute. And our duty is to contribute.
Yes, I love that. So identifying one's own unique gift that they can bring to the world and going really strong in that direction, full force in bringing that unique
absolutely
value to
absolutely
the world. I love
absolutely
that.
Yeah.
I love that. Mohamed, let's talk about your journey and how you got interested in science. You were born in Lebanon.
Right.
And then who were your influences that got you interested in science and the brain?
Wow, okay. Actually, I think brain came later, but in the beginning, I think culture in Lebanon, I means the the family issue, the parent main, I think, how to say, objective or goal is to let children educate or educate their children as maximum as parent can do, you know. So I think percentage of education in Lebanon is up to more than 99%. This is surprising for a small country. So my parent, father and mother, actually were behind my motivation to like school and to like science. It means with their, I think, some wording every day, kind of motivating me every day, was behind my starting journey, you know. Of course, also school in Lebanon was also those primary school, or not primary, secondary and college maybe. Teachers were also very really great guys to motivate all the students to run, you know. So this is maybe the beginning of my interest. And then later, to finalize, of course, again, story of culture everywhere exists, not only in Lebanon, but in Lebanon is more is to become medical doctor first. If not, you can do something else. So I was, of course, started my journey to be medical doctor. But yeah, I think you know Beirut and Lebanon, war, all these, many issues arrived and didn't help to go through. Then I tried engineering for some reason, and I liked engineering. And then from there, I was doing biomedical. So yeah. This is the story very quick.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So then, yes, this is very true. Like, parents to provide their children with as much of their own process of self-discovery and education as possible, so critical. And then it's interesting how you ended up going from, you know, doing the medical doctor to engineering to biomedical engineering.
Right.
And you've had such a long career in this space that, like, we're gonna talk about here in a moment. I wanna know what happened with this big move with the PhD. You moved to doing electrical engineering PhD at Sherbrooke University in Quebec.
Yes.
Why did you decide to move to Canada, and what was it like when you first got there?
The main reason, I think, my second language education in Lebanon was the French language. Then the possibility, as you know, Europe, France, and then this province, this state in Canada, Quebec. But the dream for a guy from Middle East is to go to as far as possible, you know, US mainly, North America. So look to the map, Canada is North America, so it fits. So this is simple reason. So I finished my college, and again, war started in Lebanon. My father pushed me out. I went to Morocco. I think Morocco, Casablanca, also good city. And from Casablanca, I did a couple of years education and engineering, and I went to Canada because my first admission to follow up for my study came from Laval University. This is in Quebec again. Mm-hmm. And I went to Canada like this, you know, so because the French. And then from Laval, this is Quebec City, this is the capital of Quebec, I went back to Sherbrooke to do master and PhD. So I did my BS in Laval, and then PhD. My PhD was collaboration with Sherbrooke and McGill University.
McGill
in Montreal, yes, as you know. Yes. And then went to University of Montreal. The engineering school is Polytechnique.
Yes.
Is famous in North America. And start my career.
Let's talk about this Polytechnic in Montreal. You spent 27 years there, from 1991 until 2018. You were professor of microelectronics and biomedical engineering, and This is you also founder and director of the PolyStim Neurotech Laboratory.
Yeah.
And that's at excuse me, that's at Polytechnic,
right.
Montreal.
Right.
Okay. So research and development in building analog and mixed signal smart devices.
Right.
And also the same 25 years experience on teaching mixed signal biomedical circuits and systems, processing this data, understanding how to do this. Okay, let's do the most fundamental explanation of this.
I see.
So how does one even start with microelectronics and biomedical engineering to start processing this incredible body and the data from it?
Right. Actually, biomedical is becoming now kind of everywhere, universal. Doesn't matter any science. You'll see guys or people, researcher doing something for bio. You know, so microelectronic is the art of miniaturizing. So it's very small. Talk now about nanoelectronic, long time ago. And nanoelectronic is connected somehow to nanotechnology. But I started again because I was interested in medical, but also I liked engineering. I starting at the first step, looking to the cochlear implant for hearing, you know, hearing. So of course, and then from there, I was because cochlear implant at the time was many people doing this, so I decided to have some innovation, and I worked on a bladder control, trying to help people to void when it's blocked, or to avoid the incontinence. Mm-hmm. So I built a kind of pacemaker. The pacemaker for the cardio is well known.
Interesting.
Pacemaker
for the bladder?
For the bladder. Okay, actually, this is again with electronic. You can take chip actually is millimeter square, as you know, very small. But you have to put some other devices in order to have everything wirelessly controlled from outside.
Wow.
So the bladder control, you can monitor on your iPhone the status of your bladder, and you can decide to go to restroom or not, you know?
This is for people that don't have good control of the bladder?
After accident, any accident, unfortunately, this pelvic floor is affected first, meaning bladder and sphincter. And then some people, they cannot void. Then they put some tube catheterization, and this is bring infection, and it is killing sometimes. It's dangerous.
Yeah.
So to avoid this, electronic, you can control by your finger, and you can power up, and you can let the bladder void, or you can have artificial sphincter to block.
So okay, let's already start talking about you're obviously solving very important biomedical issues, but we all wonder, how is this process of technology even possible? You take a very small millimeter chip, and a couple millimeter chip, and you somehow that chip has connective properties to the bladder.
Yeah.
What is this method of connection to the bladder?
Yeah,
and
right.
Then also, how does it wirelessly get controlled from the device, and what does it stimulate?
Sure. Of course, today everyone talk about IoT, Internet of Things, you know? Mm-hmm. But we were doing this long time ago to control something remote. Remote means you have, again, like any communication wirelessly, but of course was custom made to be near field. I don't want to control your implant. This is actually inside the body implant. From one side you have RF link, radio frequency. From the other side you have interface with the tissue, kind of surface electrode or cuff electrode. You have a nerve and you can put some cuff around to connect to the nerve, not to the muscle.
Yeah.
So our body is a network of nerve, a neural system, and you can go to the root of those nerves, connect there to control those organs.
So you had electrodes on this other side of the chip.
How many
electrodes did you have?
So actually, many configuration we tried to arrive to solution, but the most effective one was the 4 electrodes only.
Yeah. 4.
To control, because this is the system is...
like in a square, 4 electrodes, in or how?
It's cuff. Actually, you have the chip. It's on some PCB. From PCB, you have some outlet. Those outlet, you connect electrode with wiring, and those electrode can interface the nerve. Okay? And from the other side, you have a radio frequency system to remotely connect, receive energy to power up, and exchange data. It means you can measure what's happening, and you can receive data to turn on, turn off, update the parameter, because our body is changing.
So you wirelessly charge, wirelessly communicate with it, stimulate, get data from it.
All this.
So the electrodes, where is the process of reading out? How are you reading out this data from electrodes?
You have the nerve, you have two contact. This two contact means to inject current and stimulate.
Uh-huh.
Or these two contact is to listening what's happening.
Okay.
You can listening what's happening. You can measure from this neural system, because neural system is sensitive and motor, means keep monitoring. Our brain is intelligent, of course, is sensing what's happening. And when you need to order anything, you stimulate.
Yes.
Okay, this is its principle, very easy principle. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, the complexity is very high, but there is no limit. The sky is the limit. No anyone understand everything yet. So it's very complex. So this is the first step in my, actually it was my PhD at that time. And the motivation increased. And I said, all those organs, as everyone knows, you know, all those organs are controlled by the brain, because all these are like a keyboard, like a mouse for your computer. But your computer is the processor, is the big chip inside, right? Mm-hmm. So then I started my career as professor in Polytechnique, 27 years, to push on brain-machine interface, which is wearable, external, or implant inside. And my motivation came at that time to look to this is vision for blind. What happened? Why someone is blind? And what is the problem? So with my experience with different devices already, I decided to focus on vision. And then the game started.
Okay, yeah. So the bladder was one example.
So one example, yeah. Of my early
brain
career.
Machine interfaces to help solve a biomedical issue.
Right.
Okay. Now that field is continuing to advance.
Right.
Okay, great. And then now we're just thinking about, okay, where else can we put these, you know, these chips on the body to both read out and stimulate help heal the body.
Right.
Okay, and then where next is this vision problem.
Right,
the problem with blindness,
yeah,
and how do you solve the problem with blindness?
Right. Okay.
And some people philosophically may also make the comment that they may say that my blindness is maybe a gift, it works my other senses, but argument is they say that I would like to see. So for those that would like to see, if they are blind, this is a good for them, yes.
Yeah, actually it's vision and many other organs or function in the human body, like also hearing. If you never hear and someone show you something, doesn't matter how, doesn't mean anything for you. You have to learn again from scratch to hear. The same vision, so vision is, but vision is so very complex, means so far is the most complex function we have in our body.
Vision. Is the most complex.
The most complex.
Function.
Function.
In our body.
Yeah, sure. This is actually because it is not fully understood, because science now, as you know, medical science and all these, a lot of progress, but vision, we don't know how the brain analyzes in real time what such a beautiful life we have.
Yes.
We see color, et cetera, et cetera.
And relate it to our past life experiences. So
this
that,
is, yeah, this yeah. is connect with memory and all this these, but actually just vision,
just seeing.
You have retina and you have optic nerves and we have many stations like metro
stations.
And then you arrive to the brain. We know in the brain, on the occipital side, this is the primary region of the vision. We know that. Then from there, they have consequence of different region on the brain, unknown.
Like from the occipital, where does the neurons go? Where does the neural communication go next to make sense?
To make sense, are not known. That means maybe we know a couple of steps, but estimated we have maybe up to 10 or 15 different steps inside the brain to go. And again, when you follow up science again, you see a new publication from time to time to say, okay, no, not this region. Still not completely fully understood the different region of the brain, not only the primary region, maybe a different region. We know the cortical side is very thick, cortex, but the main part of the brain is this central part, which is hypothalamus, thalamus, and all these fundamental organ, and many things happening there. When we are unhappy, when we are sad, when we see, when we hear, there are a lot of processing, also very complex, are not fully understood yet. So working on vision.
is this most recently, or when was this? Working on vision and blindness?
No,
how long ago?
Long time ago. Maybe around 12 years ago.
12 years
I started working in Montreal on this.
On vision, okay.
And actually, if you look to Wikipedia and all this, you can see some. But today, you can find maybe more than 30 different research labs in the world, around 30, working on retina, artificial retina. Unfortunately, you have to be fresh blind, if we are blind, born blind, or if we have, we lost vision for maybe 10 or 15 years, it seems is irreversible. You cannot really recover this back.
It's hard to teach the nervous system about vision again.
Yeah. Retina cannot collaborate, etc. Many issues.
But if I get into an accident and I lose my vision, then an artificial retina can support.
Yeah, a couple of years, 2-3 years, can do something.
And you were investigating into artificial retina?
I am not.
You were?
No. I am working on the brain.
Yeah.
Because this, little people can receive artificial retina.
Yes.
Then I said, why not to look to the other region? At that time, a group in Europe was working on the optic nerves.
Yes.
Many universities, etc., supported by Medtronic at that time. And then I was following this, and then NIH in US was Illinois Institute of Technology, AIT, were supporting people to work on intracortical and the primary region of the brain. Then I went there myself. Okay, this is the right place to go. Mm-hmm. Then I was working, developing system, brain-machine interface. From one side you have camera, and you have, of course, processor external to convert image to instruction, sending inside the brain. We have there multi-unit of stimulator, and also you can record or measuring what's happening to map this image in real time in this primary region of the vision where optic nerves come. Actually, why we went there? Because actually retina, optic nerves, LGN, another network of neurons come to the, this primary region of the brain. Because these are not working anymore, so I try to do something similar with microelectronics to bring image to this region myself. So this is how it started working. I started working with vision at that time.
Yes, okay, so then we can leverage microelectronics and brain-machine interfaces to implant a solution for blindness at the end of the optical nerve?
At the primary region of the vision. Yeah, you can say at the end of this optic nerve. Yeah.
And then you have a camera
camera, it can be anywhere external.
Anywhere external, so external. I can wear it on my chest or
it doesn't
whatever.
Matter, but usually you can put in a pair of glasses to have something more realistic. And then connect it to a processor. Processor can be and behind the ear, doesn't matter where.
Yes.
Electronic chip.
And you convert images from the camera, from video, to somehow stimulation on the optical nerve.
So imagine you have now an image. Of course, we don't need
high resolution. If our eyes are closed, we would see your...
So you would see, you see the first maybe camera or the first computer with pixels.
With pixels, yeah.
So this
Okay.
Yeah,
very binary, black or
kind
white.
Kind of binary, but again, if you imagine you have 30 by 30, around 1,000 pixels, you can zoom, you can do whatever you want with this to show environment around. Because one of these pixel, one of this image, one of this pixel or electrode, because one pixel means one micro electrode.
Wow.
Micro electrode, you convert charge, electric charge to phosphine. Phosphine means point of light in our visual field, which is black. We see nothing. Imagine black, and you create white dots. With white dots corresponding to environment, you know.
Yeah. Wow. And then, so there's 1,000 microelectrodes on the...
Around 1,000, you can...
Wow. Wow. And then, you said that you can, in a sense, can they just think and zoom on their...
Yeah, actually, you have external processor again to control everything.
Okay, but not with thought. Not with thought alone. You can't zoom yet with thinking.
Right.
With external joy. There's interesting sci-fi.
Amazing.
Stuff in the future coming. Yeah, interesting. So, I was just thinking about all of the future, no limit. Yeah. Okay, so then that ended up being successful with helping people with...
Not yet. We test this in rat, in monkey.
Oh, wow.
We are developing now a more sophisticated algorithm to stimulate and doing more recording now. Means we are now listening on this region what the optic nerves bring from our normal eye. To have pattern, something very fundamental and solid, and then we can create better stimulation technique.
Yes. And I also understand that this is a very long process.
It is life project.
It's not
really 3 years project.
Yeah. And and it has to go through the trials with mice and with monkeys. You've refined the processors, the chips get better, the electrodes get better, the data, digital signal processing gets better, and you keep upgrading the algorithms. I mean, there's so much that...
Very big project, need a lot of motivation.
And then the FDA's got to approve it for you to be able to help people.
Of course.
With thousands of people and millions of dollars can be done faster. So this is why funding scientific advancements, especially when you may have a family member that would like something like this, is very important.
Right.
Okay. So this was some of the Polystim Neurotech Lab.
Yeah. So then, of course, to develop, to make this project, because actually you need to show, you know, you need to have experimental result on different step. And then I built this Polystem Neurotech lab. It's focused on neurotechnology. And with this, I have two very large, infrastructure or set of equipment. Okay, this is in Canada. We have very nice support from Canadian Foundation for Innovation. Started with my career somehow in 2000. I have resources there for the electronic, microelectronic, and for the bio side. So I can do all what kind of system I explaining in my lab. So means kind of, of course, big thanks to Polytechnic and to Canada support me very, 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 very largely, you know,
yes.
More than $40-50 million.
Wow.
With those 27 years,
yeah.
Building two large lab,
yeah.
Still there, of course.
Still there. Yeah. And how many people are still there working?
Actually, I still, now I am in leave for 1 or 2 years before
yes.
I establish myself for
here.
Good here.
Yes.
And they still have around 20 students, PhD students. Yeah, yeah,
and it's
very large.
Someone else will take over the leadership.
Actually, till now I am doing this overnight.
Of course. Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
12 hours
jet
lag. But of course, I am involving colleagues, and slowly I will delegate all this
Great.
To my colleagues.
Great, and then hopefully they keep pushing the edge for another 27 years. Really,
I hope
just
so.
Like, keep going, yeah, keep pushing.
Must be, yeah.
Yeah, it must be, yeah. And especially because these big projects help people with the biomedical solutions that are needed
for
our health and for our creativity and for our prosperity.
Sure.
Okay, so those were the big projects.
So this is one very big. Then, as you know, actually I graduated 150 students in my lab in Polytechnic.
150 students graduated from the lab.
50 PhD and
50 PhDs.
And a little bit more than 100 master's students.
100 master's.
Master is big in Canada.
That's
you know?
Very, very
Research
impressive.
Master. Yeah.
That lineage is very cool. It is.
So
okay, you know who you got influenced by?
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Who influenced you, and then who you've influenced.
Yeah, life, yeah, yeah.
It's
course,
the lineage.
Fantastic.
We
yeah.
all have that lineage of the people that we learn from and who we right, help teach. Right. Yeah, that's
great.
That's very good. And who are all now off doing important biomedical engineering.
I hope so, yeah. I have maybe not 100%, but many of them are really great former students, yeah.
Yeah.
So with this large group, of course, I was working on other project, mm-hmm. of course. So I have more recently, comparing to vision, I'm working on epilepsy.
Yes.
So epilepsy is a major issue.
Here at Westlake, doing the epilepsy?
Yeah, I am now focusing here in
okay.
epilepsy.
Okay, so let's do the transition. So that was, how long ago now has it been since the transition to Westlake?
So actually, I start here full time in January, 8 months.
Okay.
Eight, nine months only.
Okay. Okay. So you made this transition to Hangzhou, China. This is one of those. Let me find the farthest place away again from the home this time to China. And also, what else attracted you to the Westlake? Vision, and then we'll get into this epilepsy
right.
as well. Yeah.
Okay.
What else attracted you to come?
All right. So, as I just maybe said, I was extremely happy in Canada. Great support. All received all possible award, if you want, title, fellow, etc. And then I still have energy, time. I said, what's next? So motivation, actually, personal motivation. I want really to do more work, more significant work, contribute more, etc. And then was looking to the map, to the world we talk about. And then I saw China booming, and I think I will have good place to really do what I dream again to achieve before I stop working, you know.
Yeah.
Something like this.
Yes.
And before this, of course, I was I am very active. I was very active in traveling and all these. I have connection or bridges with Shanghai Jiao Tong University in Shanghai as adjunct professor. So I used to came one week per year for around 15 years. So I know, I saw China moving. and when I see this announcement from Westlake, was really something different than China, you know. So freedom and Caltech China, something like that. So yeah. I said, wow, this is the place.
Yes.
Because actually moving from Montreal to anywhere, Toronto or US, is the same environment. So yeah. I was looking to something different.
Yes.
I have the support, I have everything there. Not because I am missing anything, you know, but because I want really to do some change. I think, yeah. And our career as an academic, we can have sabbatical and we can have leave of absence. So I said, why not to do something with this? And then I decided to, and I came to Westlake. It's actually somehow very interesting or impressive the way it started. I came for an interview, I give a talk, and I was sitting in the hotel overnight, and then the president of Westlake and VP came to visit me. Wow! Can you
That's
imagine
so cool.
to yeah. say hello? Just hello means just say hi, and we are happy. Thank you for coming for the interview, and that's it.
Wow!
No yeah. 1,000 interview, no recommendation from 1,000 people, etc., etc. Wow! Okay, this is, and then they offer me the second day something.
Wow!
Like that.
Yeah.
Okay, I said actually this is. Or they asked me what I want to accept position. I said, okay, I want this. They said, this is too big. Can you accept this? I said, okay, that's it. Very simple, because I want to move. I was ready to move. And my children grew up already, so I am free somehow, relatively.
Yeah.
I don't have kids.
Kids, yeah, little ones, yeah, yeah.
And then I came here.
This desire for, you know, yeah, you had everything already, you know, like established, but you're looking for what's next. And I like that thirst for, you know, for finding what's next and seeing over the 15 years you were coming here once week per year to to Shanghai and seeing it go and you're like, and Hangzhou is just so beautiful too.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's gorgeous.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Part of China.
Yeah.
And like you said, the very like kind of like Caltech China style of vision. And so multidisciplinary and you have the potential to be this leading biomedical figure here
and inspire
lots of people from around the world that come to again build the lineage and
it's a great
transition story. Okay, so now Westlake.
okay. Yeah.
How do you pick? You know, now you're starting fresh, you're starting new.
Right.
And you have biomedical engineering is so big. So, you know, so many aspects to tackle.
Right,
the
right.
chips, the electrodes, the digital signal processing, which area of the body do you go?
Very complex.
How do you pick where to go and dedicate your time and resources?
Sure.
And epilepsy ends up being one of those decisions.
Tell us about
the difference.
Yeah, of course, in arriving here, Westlake University emerge from life science. Life science, biology, microbiology, all this chemistry somehow are connected to my work because I didn't elaborate on those devices which require also to work at the bio level, not only with the electrode. We need to manipulate neurotransmitter. We need to understand how the cell are connected together. neural cell. We have between neurotransmitter ions. So this is, we are building lab on chip in order to see this neurological or neurodegeneration problem come from. What we want to understand more, not only try to solve without with big risk.
Are you simulating the chemokinectome?
I am trying to measure them first, and not stimulating yet, but later, why not?
Okay, so measuring first, like neural transmission.
Right.
Okay, first measuring the neural transmission.
Right.
Okay, okay. And then
this
eventually.
This is the biosensor, yeah.
Down the line, you can.
This is the lab on chip.
Lab on the chip.
Abbreviation or nickname. Lab on chip, laboratory on chip.
Yeah.
Means we want to have a chip to, in the future, now we talk about millimeter, but in the future, interface at the synaptic side between neural cell is 20 wow. to 30 nano.
20 to 30 nanometers.
And we want to be there to see what's happening.
A chip on the synapse?
So, but also arriving here was this.
I'm just imagining the little chip, like watching the neurotransmission happen, and being like, okay, it's this neurochemical, and you know, and like just reporting to Mohammed sitting in the yeah. Okay, so that's the vision. Yes,
yeah,
okay.
good imagination. Okay. Yeah, it's really, the sky is the limit. You know, it's fantastic. This is why life is fantastic. Okay, life science, and then biomedical, because those different projects, I said I want really to, from one time, of course, renew my energy. Then I am building here a lab, somehow learning from all the past, having better lab, more effective. And then focusing more on brain activity, and then epilepsy is another complex dysfunction, we can say, because when those seizures emerge, the seizures emerge randomly. We never know when it happened, and no way to locate where they come from inside the brain. So.
Even if they're wearing an EEG, while it randomly happens, we don't know.
Yeah, is we try to see something, but no. Because actually when you see a forest and you have fire, you see fire come from one tree, but it doesn't mean this tree started the fire. Mm. Mm. See what my example?
So you would need to know the exact, which at that like synaptic or one individual neuron level where it started.
If not, you solve what?
Oh, sure. Now, now I see why the EEG doesn't.
Right. EEG EEG is very elementary interface, is surface.
Yes.
Brain wave means nothing. Nothing for the deep level of the brain. You can, of course, when you are sick, you can see the brain wave. It can help a little bit. You measure those signals, but it cannot solve the issue. So now, epilepsy, again, we cannot go to hospital and they put us on MRI for days. It doesn't work. You have MRI is for some scan and that's it. So you need some tools to monitor over weeks to see when a seizure emerge to catch it and to inform about.
Yes.
So this is why EEG now mix it with optic technique, which we call near infrared spectrometry. Mm. NIRS, as we heard about this expression. Mm-hmm. NIRS still with fiber optic to go a little bit deeper than the surface. Yes. Because this is non-invasive, just from external, like a helmet, you know? So, but even with NIRS, with the spectrometry, you still need big equipment to control. And so now we are building a helmet only, like a cap for the sun, you know?
Yeah.
And you can put up or down, and you can wire, and it can wirelessly connect you with the hospital, with your medical doctor, to he can see what's happening.
Is it a near infrared spectrometry hat?
Hat.
With near infrared spectrometry.
Absolutely.
Built into
yeah,
it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then, so I put it on, and then you're reading what's happening from my house.
Right.
To the
right,
lab.
Right. You can live normally, drive.
Live normally. Oh, okay. it's a wireless hat.
Wirelessly, yeah.
Wireless sure. hat.
Yeah. Wireless hat.
Wow.
Yeah. But again, this, it does not solve all the problem because you cannot go very deep inside the brain.
Even with near infrared spectrometry.
Yeah, means you can, with EEG, you can go maybe 1 centimeter, even less, including all this part, mm-hmm. skull, etc. With spectrometry NIRS, you can go maybe to 2 or 3 centimeters. No, 2 centimeters.
Wow. That's
okay, still not enough. So this is the complexity of epilepsy. What happened, even if you locate these techniques wirelessly, you locate, for example, it is emerging from here or from there or from different region, then surgeon can open, because some epilepsy are light. You have one seizure maybe every weeks or months, and it's light. You don't really lose control, etc. Mm-hmm. But some other, you have this repetitive, and it's dangerous, you can, it's really, means you can fail, etc.
If you're driving.
Okay, so the surgeon can open for the worst case and to put some other surface electrode on the brain directly and to locate a little bit better. And then if it's surface, they can do some surgery to solve, remove maybe 1 millimeter cube of tissue, and it can solve maybe 2% of cases.
And what do they identify in the little millimeter cube that tells them that's the piece to remove? What do they find there?
Okay, because actually, again, with this surface electrode, you are monitoring what's happening, and you can see this region is the strongest one emerge first. Signal processing. So again, there are maybe not 100% precision, but it's enough good sometime. Now, if not, the seizure comes from bottom side of the brain, nothing can be done.
Nothing
can be done, because you will do more side effect or destruction than solving. Brain is complex, you know? So you have some region, for example, between the two hemispheres, you have some empty place, or I don't know, but in general, if it's inside the cortex or the bottom side of this, and again, epilepsy, like vision, we don't know where it emerges first, the cow, you know? Okay, then.
So you pick that as what number focus is that? Is that number one right now at the lab focus? Or
my, yeah.
That's number one.
Number one.
Is epilepsy.
Epilepsy.
Okay. And your best strategy as the lab for that is what? What is the best strategy that you guys are taking right now?
Actually, developing better spectrometry to go deep.
You want to develop better tools to read the depths
to locate.
Yeah.
We are developing technique to detect onset. I did not finish earlier. Means now if it's deep, we develop a device like the one for the vision, a chip system to implant inside the brain, close by where those emerge. And this chip role is to detect onset maybe 15, 20 seconds before the seizure start.
Wow.
And inject some drug or stimulate the region to stop it.
To stop it, yeah.
Okay, so this is, and now the major issue is a prediction.
Yes, 15, 20 minutes, that's a good length ahead of time. I thought you were gonna say the word milliseconds. When you said 15, 20 second, millisecond prediction, no, you're like...
Second.
Full second prediction.
Second. Okay. No.
Minutes?
Detection. Wait. Detection onset. The onset, when the seizure emerge, Yes. Between 10 and 2 and 15 seconds maximum.
But before?
Before.
Okay, yeah. 2 to 10 to 15-ish.
Seconds.
Seconds.
Not minutes.
Not minutes.
Yeah, yeah, seconds. So
seconds.
It's okay. Sometimes.
That's still impressive. I thought you were going to say milliseconds.
No,
so
no, yeah.
The
yeah.
fact that you said seconds yeah. is second, still impressive. Second. Yeah, yeah, okay.
And now prediction. We want you take cell phone in the morning instead to look to the weather. You can look to see. This is, of course, the dream. Your status of your brain and your epileptic seizures stuff.
You know? Slowly decreasing because of your technology that's either stimulating to prevent the epileptic,
right. yeah.
And it's slowly teaching the brain to not have yeah. the epileptic seizures.
Yeah, means this is two steps. The detection onset is to stop it as soon as possible before it emerges. But the prediction is to predict not second. We want to predict, for example, 10 minutes, 30 minutes.
Yeah, okay.
Earlier.
Okay, okay. And get you really prepared so you're not like behind.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You drive, you yeah, stop.
So let's talk about that first part. So what right now do you and your team think will give you 2, 10, or 15 second prediction on how it's going to, where it's going to happen? And
yeah, because actually this measurement we do from epilepsy and everyone does, that mean you have what you call an interictal, preictal, okay, and ictal. Ictal is when you are in between ictal, where the seizure is already too late, and the preictal region. This is actually well known. It can be. Well known, not true, not fully known, but the idea is to be in this region as early as possible to predict. But for the detection, onset detection is done, is well known, because we have those curves, we have those measurements, and we see the seizure doesn't boom like this, boom like slowly, you know, and then go up. So this starting and up, it is the second I mentioned about. So if we are in the beginning of those second, we see something start moving, is detection, is not prediction, is detection. Mm-hmm. But the prediction, we have to analyze all the past, all data available to have intelligent algorithm, artificial intelligence, you know. We are doing deep learning with those measurement, with those database, yeah. in order to implement efficient algorithm to do this in real time and predict. I told you 10 minutes will be great. 10, 5 minutes, 15 minutes, this is the objective. This is and we are doing this, of course, the interest, not like all those guys in computer science doing algorithm, we are doing chip, because we want to put this in chip to be real-time prediction.
So do you make your own ASIC?
Right.
You make
system
your
on
own.
Chip. Yeah, this is microelectronic, yeah.
You. How did you design an application-specific integrated circuit? How did you design? How do you pick how to effectively design an ASIC for this epileptic purpose?
Right.
Yeah.
150 graduated, 150 maybe time two chip done on this field in general. My career is doing chip for all those bio application. Okay, so system on chip. I was doing this for 28 years now. So for epilepsy, again, you have a kind of a processor, custom processor to do signal analysis, okay? And to do any measurement, any stimulation, all this is really somehow my experience on that for a long time. Now, adding to this prediction, this is again neural network based kind of neural networks. This is deep learning. Deep learning, And we will have enough, of course, resources in to somehow, of course, more you have data, more you have input, more is complex, and so of course we cannot compete with a big supercomputer. I don't know how to say this, but we are optimizing those algorithms in order to make SoC with this. So SoC, system on chip, including analog, digital, RF, all these together in order to miniaturize and come with around 1 centimeter square, not 1 millimeter here, because you have a lot of material to integrate.
Whew. So yeah, the system on a chip, even with all of those incredible components, including a designed ASIC by you guys for the specific cases, for different biomedical cases, can still fit in a square centimeter.
Because now we talk about, you know, the last, how to call it, Apple have their own microprocessor, Alpha something, Bio Alpha, I don't know, I'm sorry.
The latest chip.
4.3 billion transistors.
4.13 billion
transistors.
413 billion?
Not million,
billion. 413 billion transistors?
Right.
Oh my gosh.
I estimate the chip maybe 1 inch.
1 inch?
Square.
Oh my gosh.
Not bigger, if not smaller, you know?
Does Apple work with Intel on that chip, or
I'm not sure how they develop this. No, I'm not sure. I think they have their own, but I'm not sure.
Wow,
this is using latest
impressive
technology, FinFET. The transistor FinFET.
FinFET
is like this memristor. If you heard about those wording, is at the nano scale.
Yeah.
Actually, with CMOS technology, a regular one. Those FPGA, you talk about ASICs, FPGAs, programmable devices, now they have something working on 10 nano.
Yeah,
10
nanometers.
10 nanometer.
Yeah.
So the FinFET is around 7 or 10 nano.
Wow. And then you guys use about that same level?
No, we are not really competing with this.
Okay.
Because to do analog circuit, something intelligent for the body, you don't need to run there. Maybe you can do one part. For example, if you talk about algorithm for prediction, it can be done in digital circuitry. You can have one part of the chip doing this, you know, with digital. But stimulate on the body, you still need very high current, very high voltage. Latest technology cannot help. You need to use well-established technology to generate those. For example, if you need to have 10 volt.
A 10 volt?
10 volt.
You would need that much to...
Usually we don't use volt, we use current.
Current.
To stimulate with even, I don't know, 10 micro ampere.
Yeah.
But the impedance when you where you stimulate is very high. Ohm low, you know, RE, RI. So this RI give you idea. So 10 micron time maybe 1 mega ohm give you already 10 volt, you know.
Okay. Whoa.
Yeah, so the volt is high, but the current is very, very small. We don't need energy to stimulate.
I have a question. Out of the really important part of what the lab is doing right now is identifying what the best brain-machine interface will be for solving epilepsy.
Right.
And do you have idea for what this brain-machine interface can be that's just completely brand new, that maybe the ASIC or the other components on the chip are just wildly different ideas? Is there anything like that for you to be able to provide both, like you said, you want to read out
the neural communication. You want to do the neurostimulation, which requires more significant energy to be able to do so. So, like, what could just not be think? What are we missing that could potentially be this ideal solution?
Yeah, good question. Yeah, I think the missing part here is again neuroscience is complex somehow, and as I just mentioned, maybe we should understand. Of course, to come with efficient solution, equation is well known. Diagnostic first, and if you understand, you will find solution, you know. So now, I think this long list of neurodegenerative diseases, because I will talk about vision, epilepsy, Alzheimer, memory, you have depression, you have 30 or more, you know, all come from this box, from the brain. And the connection, as I just maybe mentioned earlier, connection between, because actually we have 10 billion neurons in our brain, communication between those neurons allow us to have this fantastic life. Connection.
Yes.
So why the connection doesn't work for this and this and this and this? Mm-hmm. This is what I believe we have to sit down and understand this neurotransmission. Neurotransmission.
Yes.
We have more than 100 different neurotransmitters.
That's also crazy.
Everyone talk about dopamine and
serotonin.
A couple of, but there are, it's complex, too many, too many others.
Although so, there's a power law of the ones that are used the most.
Right. So I think this is the missing. We have really to, because building now SOC without objective is not really, interesting, you know.
Yeah.
I cannot say useless, but it's the case.
Yes.
So because you're building now, if you have good designer, good engineer, good tools, you can build. But how to, because actually put something in the brain to operate, safety, etc., energy, how to power up these, all these issue, and how long you want this to survive. So many aspects have to be addressed.
I believe it was some of the world-leading cyberneticians said that one day neuroscientists will figure out that every single problem with neurodegeneration is a problem of neural communication. And I think that's very interesting. So, if
neural communication, absolutely, connections between
neurons. So every problem that arises with the brain, depression, neurodegeneration, Alzheimer's, like epilepsy, etc., is a problem of the communication.
Right. Memory. Alzheimer are
exactly.
The same.
Yes. Another thing that we need to mention is, what are the next, you know, epilepsy, what are the next big targets for the lab?
Yeah. So in, as I told you, in parallel, I was thinking on respiration and stroke and Alzheimer, those three. And I don't stop working on vision.
And still with vision too, okay.
But those three emerging strokes, can we predict? Because now, of course, too late again, stroke happened and nothing can be done. The idea to do some, again, prediction, having solution. Respiration, this is not a new project also, but is...
Asthma or?
Is apnea. Or?
Apnea. What's the apnea?
Apnea is actually newborn or elderly they have some stop of respiration for some reason.
Like the sleep apnea. Sleep apnea, and you can't breathe well,
and you need to stay there. Yeah, yeah.
You need the oxygenation mask.
Right.
Okay, and so you want to, for newborns and elderly, do the respiration apnea. Okay, that's one of them you want to solve, the apnea.
To solve it.
You think the apnea is also the neural communication problem?
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's actually so interesting. That one I hadn't thought of before. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm developing a feedback system to detect the stop, the onset stop of respiration, and then stimulate the epiglottis nerve. Epiglottis nerve coming from the brain is here somewhere.
To trigger the lung?
To trigger the, you
know, the respiration process.
To not stop.
Wow.
So you can
to stimulate respiration for apnea. Yeah, I want, okay, interesting. So, what were your thoughts for, you said stroke and Alzheimer's. And Alzheimer's. And how, those are big ones. I always like to mention this one especially for Alzheimer's, because we have this beautiful library that we have in our brains, and the neurodegeneration is the burning of the books in the library, and this is a big problem.
It's one of my favorite analogies.
Okay, so what do you think for the stroke and for the Alzheimer's? How do you handle the neurocommunication problem? How do you solve it?
Yeah, actually, almost the same principle. Again, the idea is to learn this, maybe from blood pressure, from heart behavior, from those ECGs. The idea is to avoid to go up to the brain. But with the nerves technique we are developing, we can see the blood status inside the brain, and which can help to detect earlier and predict. This is almost the same principle, but actually I think in stroke must be easier than epilepsy, because this is the blood circulation everywhere. Must detect something earlier, and with again data coming from different network, we can do some prediction.
Do you see? I want to ask you this question, because many people that watch would probably want me to ask you this one. Out of the last 25 years of building the lab, and now building this lab, what are some of the most important principles, essentials for labs, for the success of the lab? What needs to happen in the fabric of the lab to have high success?
Yeah, this is a fantastic question. Again, I think many parameters, not only one, you know. For example, in life, you have to be smart and you have to be hard worker. If you are smart only, forget about. If you are hard worker without be intelligent also, doesn't help. So I think a lab, we need support to have facility to build stuff, but those facility, of course, are source of motivation to everyone to attract top-notch student. Actually, student, PhD student, constructing their future are the main reason to have success, in my opinion. Because even you are alone and work very hard, a lot of idea, but the idea need people to realize, you know. So student and of course the staff around. I am fortunate, and all new professor here in Westlake, we have good support. We have those resources we can have. We have the staff we need. We are trying to hire the best student to work with us.
Do you feel like how do you keep up with the constant advancements that are happening in the literature with the brain? How do you read all of the advancements so that you can stay at the cutting edge in your advancements of the brain machine interface?
This is not easy job, no free lunch. You have really to you have really to monitor. Actually, I spend a lot of time in front of my screen and work hard. I am involved also in IEEE organization. I think you know IEEE. I am well means how to say involved. Presently, I am editor in chief of the best journal in the society where I am, Circuit and System. The name is Transaction and Biomedical Circuit and System. We are doing chip for bio general, not for brain interface, for bio in general. And I am VP publication, vice president on this society for all those literature. I am general chair next year in Montreal organizing the biggest conference on the field biomedical. This is Engineering, Medicine and Biology Society, EMBS. We talk about around 3,500 attendees working on bio, and maybe one portion of them working on brain. And I am, of course, involved in life science on different society, so I'm trying to follow up and ask my group to help reading some material from time to time.
Do you feel like we're moving in the direction where in maybe 50 years or so that we will have a constant stream of our biometrics, including the whole chemoelectroconnectome and all of our heart and our microbiome and all of the data being fed up to the machine learning algorithms to predict pathology and to give us the recommendations to live the maximum lifespan? Do you feel like that's...
You describe very well. I think so. I think so. This is doable. This is doable. Now, of course, I used to really differentiate between science fiction and real science. So I am doing real science myself. I want really to help. I want to solve problem. Now, of course, in the future, if we look to the progress, I think the progress in this field, brain-machine interface, is not very old. We talk about maybe, of course, stimulation like pacemaker is now more than 70 years old, 70. The first pacemaker was big like that, but now miniaturization, of course. So maybe last 20, 30 years booming, and now, of course, you can wire T-short and you can measure any parameter wirelessly, you know, ECG, EEG, etc., all these pressure with your watch. So, we cannot solve all problem, in my opinion, because human body machine is very complex, and the complexity is limited. Is not really now is not really quantified. Something not quantified, you cannot really predict, you can solve, you know.
You can measure every protein, every atom.
Even you cannot dream, you know. Too much. But of course, in maybe again 20 is tomorrow, you know. In 50 years, we'll have better, I think, control of our human being in general. I think more precise. Means if you compare now maybe with years, how progress in term of actually now people are living older and older because healthcare is improving, very clear. You know, it means if you go 50 years ago, the life, I don't know, means life hope, or people were hoping to live 40 years or 50 years, you know. Now we talk about 90 years, 50 years later. So it means, yeah, we'll survive longer. Very clear.
Yeah. And not only predict the pathologies so that we can live longer, make the interventions, but also that we can do things like, for my own success, like you mentioned at the very beginning, can we have our little AI assistants that can coach us through the best possible life trajectory for us to take on that next big challenge, and to help guide us to the next big challenge, and how we can be our best selves. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, for your kids and their kids. And
Sure.
A couple last questions on the way out. What are your thoughts on the meaning of life?
The meaning of life. Yeah, this is more philosophical question, I think. Yeah, the meaning of life. I think one word is magic. Life is magic. Is very difficult to really define. You know, your question is very complex. Actually, this is connected to also to the believing of everyone. So what I believe on that is we have a creator. This creator is not really, doesn't have laptop, or I don't know. This is something we cannot quantify, you know, and create a human, create all stuff around. Actually, if you look to any, we talk about atoms, and we talk about molecules, we talk about, this is really a huge complexity to explain and to connect with the human, why a human is here, you know. I believe the creator is magic, again, the word, and we cannot really one day try to do the same, or we cannot say this is by accident we are like this here. Mm. This is not by accident, no.
It's magic.
Magic.
What a good word. Yeah. And
actually, I am a French guy. Maybe the word in English are missing, but I think try to explain my idea as clearly as possible with the language I have, you know. Anyway.
Yes.
Good?
Yes.
Magic, yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Is there a French word that does a better job?
Yes, it's common.
What's the French word?
Magique.
Magique. Yeah. Okay, good. Yeah.
Magic.
I love that. Yeah. I use c'est la vie.
C'est la vie.
That one quite a bit.
Absolutely, I like c'est la vie. Yeah, this is great. Yeah. Actually, when you don't have explanation, c'est la vie.
Yeah. I must ask you as well, thoughts on consciousness. Is it the biological phenomenon? Does it come and take a seat in this body? And then go back to the source. How does the consciousness work?
Yeah. Actually, I am not strong on this, but but I think again, the body is nothing, is material, you know. But and the brain is material. But the consciousness, or there are a wording.
The whole is greater than the sum of the parts.
Right. But we have actually, because our life is controlled by the creator. He can stop it anytime. Mm. Okay, he needs some reason, accident or stroke, but he decided to stop it. And it stopped it. But the body is nothing, it's like material, like, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So this consciousness or, or controlled by what you call God or by the creator.
The spirit or the spirit. Soul.
The soul, yeah, I was searching for the soul. The soul is something different than all the others.
The soul or the spirit is limitless, is not material.
It's not material. It's virtual, real virtual.
Magic. And do you think that this is a simulation?
What we have now?
Yes.
There are another word what we call emulation. You know what that means?
Emulation.
Emulation means, because simulation is only software running. Only software. But emulation is a kind of prototype or something working. It's not the, for example, I can do implant big like this, prototype to show I can do, and then I miniaturize later. Emulation. I don't think this is emulation or simulation. This is the real world, c'est la vie. Real world. It means, of course, I believe again, when the soul will quit my body, I will have different body maybe or different look, but elsewhere. I will not disappear completely from, I will disappear from life, from this real life to another, I don't know, maybe different planet or different, or only a virtual, I don't know. This is magic.
Magic.
Yeah.
And the last question, what is the most beautiful thing in the world?
This is very difficult question. Yeah. Yeah, I think the most beautiful things, because think is big, it's small and big word. I think it doesn't come like this, but in general, be happy. Be happy, find a way to be happy in life. And be happy doesn't mean you have last Mercedes car or 100 children or best lab in I don't know where. Be happy, it can be as simple as I have, as you have preliminary condition to have what you want in life. Be happy, and I think that means you can be very poor and happy, you can be very rich and happy, so it doesn't matter. This is not really material, be happy for me. Be happy is maybe have good family, have enough revenue to survive. I don't know, so be happy.
Mohammed, thank you. Thank you so much for coming on our show.
Thanks a lot.
I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for inviting me.
You're so welcome. You're doing incredible work here. We wish you the absolute best with the future of
thanks
your
a
lab
lot.
Here.
Yeah,
thank
thanks
you.
A lot. Yeah.
Thanks everyone for tuning in. We greatly appreciate it. We'd love to hear your thoughts in the comments below on the episode. Let us know what you're thinking. Also, check out the links in the bio below to Mohammed's work and to the lab here at Westlake. Check out all those links in the bio below. Also, have more conversations with your friends, families, coworkers, people online about brain-machine interfaces, about how we can really tap into neurotechnology to tackle some of the most complicated neurocommunication issues and neurodegeneration issues. And also, support the artists, the entrepreneurs, the leaders around the world that you believe in. Support them and help them grow. You can support Simulation. Our links are below so we can continue doing cool things like coming to Westlake to interview some of the smartest minds out here. And go and build the future, everyone. Manifest your dreams into the world. We love you very much. Thank you for tuning in, and we will see you soon. Peace. That's a wrap.
Great,
that was
great,
so fun.
Great, yeah.
May I also
you
ask...
You do great job. Thank incredible. You know, incredible. Congratulations. Yeah. Fantastic.
After,
promoting
after
science.
1,000
this is fantastic. Yeah. For the young.
I adore you and all the other people that come on this
You are great.
Thank you, my brother.